This is Whitley Strieber, and this is a Dreamland video presentation. You have reached the edge of the world. Well, today on Dreamland, we have Robert Schoch back with us. Robert is one of our favorite guests on this show. He has been on Dreamland a number of times, and it's always been incredibly exciting. And believe you me, this is going to be exciting today, because he has revised and expanded forgotten civilizations. We've talked about it before, but wow, Robert, this is going to be exciting. But before we start, I have to report on something for my listeners and my subscribers involving some radios. Last week's show with Mark Sims, we talked about these little radios, which when you set them to a frequency, 144.100, which should be entirely silent, they begin at times, not always, but at times, they begin to make a little beeping sound, indicating that the radio is being, circuits are being excited by an unknown frequency. I have tested this extensively, both in this house and elsewhere. In this house, as you saw last week, the radio starts to cheep incessantly. Elsewhere, it does not. I also have used an RF meter a radio frequency analyzer to see if the frequency is active when this is happening, and it isn't. So that's the report on that. Now, oops. See, that's not supposed to be happening. It is very strange. It happens more near my implant, and I'm going to turn it off now. It is. I just wanted to let the folks know where we were with this. And Jimmy Blanchett will be with us shortly. He's the expert, radio expert, who has discovered this phenomenon and hopefully understands it. Now, let's get on to forgotten civilizations. And Robert, I want to start at a kind of a funny point. You have a remarkable short section in here called Fluctuating Fields, Consciousness and the Cosmos. And I look around me in my world, our world, and I see a lot of people seem to be just basically going crazy. Mm. And the magnetic field is unstable also. So can you talk to us a little bit about, to begin, about the relationship between consciousness, the mind, and fluctuations in the magnetic field?
Well, we found that there are a lot of correlations between magnetic fields, consciousness, fluctuations. When you look at, for instance, and I think some of the most compelling evidence is correlations between, for instance, geomagnetic activity, which is highly correlated with solar activity, because the cosmos, the sun, the solar system, the earth are all linked together magnetically. And a lot of what we call electromagnetic radiation, radio frequencies, etc., they're all part of the same spectrum. In fact, it was interesting that you were just talking about the radio and the radio fluctuations. And I have to wonder if some of that has to do with maybe solar activity, because we now are finding that solar activity is affecting so much that is going on. But to get back to, I think, more specifics, we find, for instance, certain types of paranormal phenomena, and I use this as an extreme example, but it's a good example, where paranormal phenomena, for instance, have been correlated with geomagnetic fluctuations, which are correlated with solar fluctuations, and this has been found to occur over A data set that spans more than 100 years. So you have a situation where you can look at geomagnetic fluctuations, you can look at what most people consider anomalous mental activity, anomalous consciousness, things like telepathic experiences, etc. And again, I use this as sort of a marker that we can definitely say, okay, so-and-so had a telepathic experience. And what you find is that there's good records, for instance, put together by various societies like the Society for Psychical Research, which has been collecting data since the late 19th century. You can now correlate this with geological data, geomagnetic data, astrophysical data, and find correlations between these different phenomena. And for the skeptics to say that this is all nonsense really gets to the point of absolute ridiculousness, because you would have to say that somehow people were faking these various, say, telepathic experiences or poltergeist-style experiences, and somehow they were faking them consistently to correlate with geomagnetic phenomena as if they would even know about the geomagnetic phenomena. So we're finding these correlations. We're also finding that there are correlations between cosmic phenomena. I'll call that cosmic phenomena. For instance, our relationship to the center of the galaxy is very important when you look at various types of, we'll call it, again, I use the term loosely, paranormal mental consciousness phenomena. But we find that there's also correlations between even what should be physical phenomena, like the reactions of chemicals, radioactive decay rates. These are all apparently modified and modulated by our relationship to the cosmos at large and our relationship specifically within the solar system and relative to the sun. These are things that should not be occurring whatsoever. So, to give another example, at a very fundamental level, radioactive decay rates are supposedly, according to classic physics, including quantum mechanical models, they should be relatively stable, independent of any types of outside influences, with a few exceptions. There are a few exceptions involving, for instance, very, very, very high voltages that are accepted by some mainstream scientists, but things like the distance between the Earth and the Sun or solar flare activity is so trivial, it should have no effect, according to standard science, on such phenomena. Yet, over decades of data, or years and decades of data, we find that there are correlations even at these most fundamental levels that are driving, or at least indicating an interconnectedness between the most basic fundamental physical phenomena that we can imagine or that we are aware of, and very large-scale solar system scale, galaxy scale, and I think ultimately cosmic scale phenomena. So there are these interconnections, and something I have really been struck by in my 30 plus years of studying such things, because I went in as an absolute skeptic, absolute sort of diehard initially classically trained scientist. But I believe in looking at the data, and the data indicates that there are all these interconnections that most people to this day, when I say most people, academics, they don't want to acknowledge at all. And then this gets back into consciousness. What is consciousness? And I am more and more convinced, in fact, I am convinced, that really consciousness is fundamental. So when you're talking about these interactions, you're talking about interactions at a cosmic level affecting the microcosm, we're really talking ultimately about consciousness. And consciousness, I have come to conclude, is the most fundamental aspect of anything the universe. Everything really seems to come from consciousness. So my point at this very moment, when I'm talking about consciousness and everything comes from it, well, everything that is being affected at a physical level that ultimately affects mental processes as we think of them and ultimately affects consciousness.
Now, if this is true about consciousness, and I think it is. In fact, my own experience of life would certainly suggest that this is very true. What does that say about things like stars and planets and the degree of consciousness that is in them?
Yeah, it's hard to understand, I think. It's hard for us because we experience one level, one type, one style, if I could, of consciousness. And many people want to, when I say many people, I'm actually thinking primarily of my academic scientists, colleagues. They, in some cases, don't even want to acknowledge consciousness, even in humans. But that's a very extreme case, I think, that comes out of, you know, classic 19th century academic scientific
right.
materialism. But what I want to get back to is that let's posit, let's hypothesize for a moment that everything is conscious at some level. And when I say some level, we have a difficulty, I think, of even understanding what consciousness can be for other types of entities. I don't say other types of organisms. A fruit fly is conscious. I have absolutely 100% no doubt a fruit fly is conscious, and a fruit fly has a consciousness and a consciousness level that I suspect is very, very similar to humans at a basic level. On the other hand, a star is probably conscious. In fact, I'm convinced that stars are conscious. I will say that bluntly to your audience. And I think there are very good reasons for concluding that stars are conscious. But how do we measure that? How do we see that manifested? Stars are not organisms as we think of them. Per se, but that doesn't mean they can't be conscious. Now, there are certain astrophysical, I'm convinced, and again, it's good to have heuristic speculation, but certain phenomena, for instance, among stars that are very, very inexplicable as to why stars move as huge clusters together, etc. People look for all kinds of physical phenomena, dark matter, dark energy, etc., that could be driving them. But if we simply, and I give this as an example, if we simply hypothesize that they are conscious and also have some control by shooting out jets in one direction or another, or shooting out what we'll call solar flares or outbursts, which can control their behavior, and if we assume that they're conscious and interacting with each other, think of a group of birds flying together in formation. Think of a group of fish swarming through the oceans. It doesn't take much, I think, to imagine, okay, they're conscious, they have some control as we do over their mobility, their movements, their expression, if you should say. And all of a sudden, a lot of things that seem inexplicable to me become explicable. Then there's another aspect that we have to take into account. We humans live for a period of, say, the typical human, maybe 75 years, let's just say 75 to 95 years, a good long lifespan. So we have this concept of a temporal frame in terms of those decades. What about something like a star or the Earth? If the Earth is conscious, which I suspect it is at some fundamental level, it has a very different temporal perspective. What we may see as just, no movement, no interaction, no expression of consciousness may simply be a matter of our time scale, our time frame. Let me give you another analogy to think about. We are covered with bacteria. We have all kinds of microbiota within us. We have a gut biome full of different types of bacteria and other small little organisms. Some of them are eukaryotic, some of them are small multicellular, etc. Each one of those, I think we can posit, has consciousness, and we can demonstrate that they interact, that they have movements, they interact with stimuli, etc., all the classic aspects you would measure to show that they have consciousness. So there you can make a very, very strong case. Are they aware that they're on or in another being at a higher level or at a bigger level, physically bigger level, that's conscious too? Or is that little bacterium that's, you know, crawling around on my forehead, oh, it doesn't know it's on a on
forehead,
another.
Of course not. And we don't know. I don't think, I think we're in a larger consciousness too that
exactly.
we don't recognize. I think that's what
exactly.
you've just been
we're,
talking
we're like
about.
We're like a little microorganism.
Right, exactly.
Forehead.
Now, free dreamlanders, we're going to take a brief break for you. So listen to and or watch these commercials.
Support unknowncountry.com and its great mission to make contact happen. Use our vast archive of interviews, meditations, commentaries, news, and Whitley Strieber audiobooks to expand your mind and your understanding of close encounter. Meet others who have similar interests on our active free message board or in our subscriber comments and Wednesday night chats. There is no other site like Unknown Country in or out of this world. Go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe today.
How curious are you? How much do you really want to know about the world you live in? There are, for example, very real conspiracies. We're talking about one of them today. And this is a place where if it's real, we're going to talk about it, but not if it's not real. So there's no confusion here. If we're talking conspiracy on Dreamland and on unknowncountry.com, it's because we can prove it, just like we can prove that the Roswell incident has been covered up. We can prove these things. We can prove that the abduction phenomena is in some way very real. We can prove that there are unusual materials in this world because some of them are right here in my possession. So, this is an unusual place. It's a unique place, and above all, it is a great place to explore. Exploring the unknowncountry.com archive is a really extraordinary experience. It's a place where you can regain what we are losing, which is a lost sense of wonder and a willingness and to explore the unknown. We live in a terribly difficult world right now. This place is an oasis of wonder. Join unknowncountry.com today. Okay, we're continuing with Robert. We've been talking about consciousness and it's deeply in fact, let's say that what we think of consciousness as being a kind of a field in reality, but I think that reality is probably a field in consciousness.
Yeah, it's
the opposite.
I think I've really come to the conclusion, and I think it's well founded at this point, that consciousness comes before everything else. It's prior
Absolutely.
To everything else. Reality as we know it is a manifestation of consciousness, and consciousness on a universal level, should we say, and then individual consciousnesses that have split off but still share commonalities, including
yes.
the commonality of how we create the world, essentially.
How we create the our version of the world, because there is a, I would say it's almost a profound innocence about consciousness, in the sense that it is going to let what happens happen. And that's why we have free will. This is absolutely essential for its continued journey. Now, speaking of the journey of consciousness, I would like to turn now to the journey of human consciousness and what our consciousness was like in the past that you understand certainly as well as anybody living and maybe who has lived on this planet. And I would like to go back, for example, we'll go to Göbekli Tepe in a moment, but first let's go to Stonehenge, which we know a little bit about, more about in terms of the population dynamics that were unfolding in the British Isles at the time. There were about 30,000 people living in Britain at the time Stonehenge was built, living in the British Isles, at the time Stonehenge was built, first in Wales and then apparently moved to its present location in southern England. It was constructed over a period of 500 years. Now, I may be wrong about that. I mean, if so, correct me, but it was a very long process. That is clear. And you moved and hewn using techniques that are not clear to us anymore. What in the world, what kind of mind could do something, anything, over a span of time like that? We have nothing in our culture that's right now, that we are, no project that we are working on culturally anywhere that started 500 years ago and continues now. Our projects last a few years.
Our projects last a few years, and then they only last, they're made to only last 30 years or so. I'm
right.
You know, you build a nuclear power plant, and nuclear power plants, I think, are very, very problematic. But we won't go into that right now, although I do want to mention that with a major solar outburst, all the nuclear power plants, that's one problem we have because we'll have Fukushima's all over the place. But to address your question, we build things like nuclear power plants that really have a life expectancy of only 30 years or so, much less thinking about building something over a period of 30 years or over centuries. I do want to mention that Stonehenge, I've spent some time looking into Stonehenge. The traditional dating of Stonehenge goes back, let's say, 2,500, 2,600 before the Common Era. So let's just say in round numbers, it goes back 4,600, 5,000 years. I'm not absolutely convinced of that, because what we're finding, what I am finding, and we now have evidences of this even at Stonehenge, is that a lot of these ancient sites were reused. They actually, their origins go back earlier to what I call an earlier cycle of civilization, as you know from reading the book. And there was a huge time lag between these earlier civilizations, which were really extinguished for all effective purposes at the end of the last ice age, and then reemerge later. And I do think we see some evidence for that at Stonehenge as well. For instance, even the standard status quo archaeologists have now acknowledged that Stonehenge has predecessors on site. There's evidence that the site was used and occupied much, much earlier. And this ties in with what you were saying. So we're not even talking 500 years. We're talking thousands of years that this site was used and reused, and incredible continuity. And I see this around the world as I've been studying ancient cultures for the last 30 plus years, that these were people who were not short-sighted as we are now. I believe that our modern civilization is incredibly short-sighted. We tend to think at most 5 years, generally down the line. We don't think in terms of what, future projects and taking on projects that will take generations to complete. In fact, we don't even think about the consequences, in my opinion. I don't want to sound preachy here, but we don't even think about the consequences of what we're doing.
No.
More than a few years down the line. And this leads us into all kinds of problems where we put our faith in traditions, our technologies, or societal, shall we say, norms that are going to have dire consequences. And one thing I see, and I want to get back to your question about what were these people like. I think they had a much longer term concept of the future and the past, the cycles of the cosmos. And I believe this ties in with what we were talking about before, consciousness and the cosmic setting, if I could put it that way, and that they were much more attuned to how we humans are part of a larger cycles, bigger picture, if I could put it that way. And we tie in with everything from humans and humans having a place on this earth in the cosmos and having consciousness. I wanted to mention that something I talk about in Forgotten Civilizations, even the concept that hydrogen atoms encode information, and I'm convinced are conscious at some level. So even at that level, the smallest particles have some consciousness. So I don't want to digress too much, but I think these people had a much larger perspective when it came to time, when it came to how we fit in, and that allowed them to see continuities so they could start projects, they could carry out projects that they realized might not occur in their personal physical lifetime,
yes,
but saw them as continuous, and they saw themselves as part of a larger continuity. I think they also had a much stronger belief in, and well-founded belief, that there is something beyond just this, what would Lincoln say, four score years that on average that we have in this bodily form, and this ties back into the whole consciousness.
Right.
And that you aren't totally obliterated in a, as many materialists would have it, when you die. So it makes sense to be part of this bigger picture. I also am convinced that in the last, and I use the term last cycle of civilization that goes back to really before the end of the last ice age, we have only the slightest glimmerings of what they had in terms of knowledge-based technological aspects, etc. So how did they move some of these things? How did they transport them? Yes, we can hypothesize that they used incredibly primitive means, but even when some people have tried to replicate using these, quote, classic primitive means, it hasn't always been successful. And for them to have done that consistently, boggles the mind. I'm often asked, for instance, how did they build the pyramids? And my answer is really, I don't know at this point.
Right.
Built. And I studied in Egypt for decades, but
right.
I'm not going to claim to know how they did it. And I'm not going to make up some simplistic story just to have an answer.
The planet's full of things like that. The fortress at Sacsayhuaman in Peru, Nan Madol, the huge in the Carolina Islands, all of those gigantic basalt logs that came from somewhere, and you know, basalt's incredibly hard.
Exactly.
And yet somebody built an artificial island out of basalt.
And it's not just one example. I mentioned briefly in for the latest edition of Forgotten Civilization, Gunung Padang on Java.
Right.
In a very similar manner. So this is something that was being done.
In ways that we no longer can function. And, you know, speaking of, I've always felt that the more materialistic our civilization has become, and the more divorced from the other level of reality that you referred to, the less future we recognize, until at this point, our future seems to have been to just be literally a few months, or maybe at most a few years, and we don't see beyond that. We've forgotten the future.
Yeah, I think a lot of people I know on an everyday level, they really don't see beyond a few years at most. Plus, and I don't want to sound preachy, but I feel that with the technology that we are more, when I say we, society as a whole, Western Occidental society as a whole, is becoming more and more dependent on, sophisticated electronics. Yeah, it's wonderful. It's allowing us to have this conversation right now. But we are also becoming more dependent on it. We're becoming more divorced, in my opinion, from what really counts, what really matters at a consciousness and spiritual level. And again, I don't want to sound preachy, and I'm not that way.
No, don't worry about it.
But on the other hand, and this is the point I really want to make as a scientist, we are becoming more and more vulnerable to natural phenomena.
Very much so.
Solar outburst. And this is part of the theme of my book, as you know.
Now, let's pause here, because I'm going to do a break. For our free Dreamlanders, enjoy the break, enjoy the commercials. I'm just writing down the time of the break, because I don't have a producer here due to COVID. And so we're taking a break now. My new book, Jesus, A New Vision, is an entirely new vision of the life of Jesus and what happened after. Among many other things, it is about why the resurrection happened and what happened to the teaching of Jesus that led to the creation of Christianity. It's an extraordinary and virtually untold story. Graham Hancock, author of Fingerprints of the Gods, says, "Whitley Strieber's take on Jesus is thought-provoking and inspiring. This is an important investigation filled with new insights. Highly recommended." Toby Johnson, author of Finding Your Own True Myth, What I Learned from Joseph Campbell, says, "Very wise and satisfying for the contemporary mind. My book does not deny the divinity of Jesus, but it looks at the power of the human mind and the human soul in a whole new way." It's available as a Kindle, as a paperback, and as an audio book on Apple Books and on Amazon.com. Listen to this sample from the audio book. Reading the canonical Gospels with the eye of a detective reveals much that has been hidden more or less in plain sight. For example, it is clear that Jesus intentionally goaded the Romans into killing him. I think that the reason that he did this is understandable, as I will discuss. He was also helped by a group of people who are almost invisible in the Gospels, but not quite. They must have been incredibly learned. In fact, they must have known and understood the secret of death itself, and thus how to surmount it. They were not members of any known order, such as the Essenes. So who were they? And for that matter, as he was not a deity come to earth, who was he, really? Using a combination of a re-examination of his story and the application of scientific tools to, for example, study the Shroud of Turin, we can make exciting strides toward recovering the secrets that they must have known. Some of them are hidden in the shroud, which it would now appear cannot have been a medieval forgery, as was incorrectly concluded back in 1988. As shall be seen, the evidence refuting that conclusion is strong. The implications of the resurrection event are amazing and exciting, and have something very new to say not only about Jesus, but about us. Jesus, A New Vision. Get it today.
1968, Glynis Mackay is a desperate woman. She's been told she's dying of cancer. She can no longer speak. She receives a psychic communication from aliens that she has been in touch with for years. Listen to her talk about what happened.
I went into this huge room, and there were many other people sitting and some lying on couches that had come there for healing. And then he said to me, "You understand who sent you here to me?" And I'm thinking, what does he mean? And then he said, "You've been having communication for many, many years from what who you call UFOs." And I thought, my God, how does he know this? And I'm trying to sort of push back on the chair, looking a bit shocked probably. And he said to me, "When you leave here at 12:10 today, there are two craft over the house and you will see them."
And she and her mother-in-law both saw a UFO hanging over their house. Subsequently, Glynis's cancer disappeared, and she went on to become one of the world's most extraordinary mediums. UnknownCountry.com and Dreamland are among the very few places Glynis has interviewed. She became close friends with Anne Strieber and with myself, and in our own personal lives revealed some extraordinary experiences. I had a contact with a dead friend so incredible with Glynis that it convinced me that there must be something more. There almost has to be. In fact, many things have taken me in that direction, but this was just shocking. In any case, you can hear all of this as a subscriber to UnknownCountry.com by going to our vast archive. It's so simple to search. Just look at the subject cloud on the left side after you enter the subscriber area, and you'll find so much there. Go to UnknownCountry.com right now and subscribe. It's an immensely valuable and deeply empowering archive, and the site needs your support.
And Robert, we're coming back, and we were just about to talk about the vulnerability of mankind, which is just extraordinary. And it's one of the most sobering things in the new edition of Forgotten Civilizations. Can you tell us a little bit about our star, the sun, and the reality of its stability or instability?
Well, I have come to this conclusion, and a lot of people don't want to hear it. I don't even like having to say it.
But this is a different audience. We're all ears.
And yes, our sun, whether we like it or not, is a pretty standard star. There's nothing super special about our star. And I don't mean to degrade it whatsoever, but where I'm coming from is that stars go through periods of stability and instability. And our star does that just like most other stars do. And what we have found, what I'm finding, and what the evidence is really backing me up on, and this is actually a development, as you know, personally, from seeing the old edition and the new edition, I speculated about this much more initially in the first edition, almost a decade ago now, and since then, a lot of evidence has come out, astrophysical evidence, that has confirmed what I was suggesting, which is that our sun, like many other stars, undergoes periodic solar outbursts. I like the term solar outburst because it includes things like coronal mass ejections, major solar flares, etc., etc. This affects Earth. It can literally cause what seem like huge lightning strikes to hit Earth, cause vitrification on Earth. Vitrification is when it's so powerful that it can melt surface rocks and then they recongeal in certain spots. Even a minor solar outburst is going to knock out our modern electrical systems, grid systems, that type of thing. We had a major solar outburst, I'm absolutely convinced, based on the evidence, at the end of the last ice age, about 9700 before the Common Era. So 11,700 years ago, that decimated what I refer to as an earlier cycle of civilization, which was the cycle of civilization during which the original Great Sphinx, has its origins. That's the time of the original Göbekli Tepe. We were just talking about Stonehenge before one of the breaks, and I think the earliest glimmerings of Stonehenge actually go back to that period. So this was incredibly devastating at 9700 BC. What happens, and I've been thinking about this a lot, I believe that our sun probably has a cycle, a periodicity of about 11,000 to 13,000 years. So it goes through periods, and I'm abbreviating here for the sake of going quickly. It goes through periods of a couple of thousand years where it has extreme activity. It basically, a star has to be in equilibrium, but it will go into disequilibrium after a while. It builds up pressures, it builds up disequilibrium in its system, then it relieves it again. You can think, I'm a geologist, so I often use analogies from Earth. You can think of the Earth building up forces which then relieve themselves as earthquakes and volcanic activity, which actually have been now found to correlate with solar activity, of all things. But that's another story for maybe a few moments or
a little while later, because it's a very important story, and we'll talk about it in the last half hour.
Okay, so we have a situation where our sun goes through periods of instability, by my estimate, for a couple of millennia with some major solar outbursts. This happened at the end of the last ice age, which began and ended what's sometimes known as the Younger Dryas. I make the case in the book that there was no comet that hit anywhere close to the end of the last ice age. It was actually solar activity, and all the evidence that's been proposed, if people have heard about a comet hitting at the end of the last ice age, the evidence actually fits better solar activity. So that's number one. But since 9700 BC, the sun has been more stable than it was in 9700 BC or BCE. But we have found in the last 10 years that a number of periods had very high solar activity. So, and the data is still coming in, but we can already document, for instance, in the 6th millennium BC, there was a major solar activity, and there were half a dozen other periods of major solar activity in the last 8,000 or so years.
Now, the 6th millennium BC would be close enough for us to be able to analyze what happened historically to a degree.
Yeah.
I mean, not a great degree, but we could can see a little bit of that. Can you tell us a little bit about what the record shows?
Yeah, so what the record shows is that, and a lot of this is based on dendrochronology and looking at tree rings, which then look at various isotopes, or will record various isotopes that record solar activity, that is various types of solar outbursts, major solar flares, geomagnetic fluctuations. You have that in tree ring data. You have that in sediment and ice core data. And analyzing this carefully, what we find is that there were a number of periods of activity, not as extreme as at the end of the last ice age, but still anomalous compared to what we know for the last 1,000 years or so. One of them was actually in the reign of Charlemagne, about 775, 774, somewhere in there, AD. And people at the time, they recorded unusual activity, weird things in the sky. You could analogize those to the northern and southern lights that people know now. But what this is, what was happening is that plasma, electrical plasma, high, fast-moving electrified particles spewing off, thrown off by the sun, hit Earth, caused all kinds of disruptions geomagnetically, geophysically, cause lights in the sky, aurora-type phenomena that people recorded. And you can record, in some cases, increased earthquake activity, that type of thing. Now, in the last 5,000, 6,000, 7,000, 8,000 years, we did not have incredibly sophisticated electronics.
No.
And that type of thing. All of these phenomena that I'm talking about that have occurred, say, at least half a dozen times in the last 8,000 years, and that's only the tip of the iceberg, I believe, because it's only the ones that have been discovered so far in the record, and it takes work to find these. None of them were known when I published the first edition of Forgotten Civilization, so this is all very recent data confirming what I've said. But the point I want to make is that all of these are so powerful, were so powerful, that if one of them happened today or tomorrow or next week, you and I would not be having this conversation. Certainly, it would knock out power grid systems around the world. It would knock out communication systems around the world, et cetera, et cetera. The modern technological world and billions of people, it would be devastating.
Well, yeah, you know, I wrote a little ebook called Solar Flares a few years ago, and when I was writing that book, I came across a study that I believe was conducted in the Department of Energy. I could be wrong about the origin of the study, but the study showed that 10 years after an event like that, the population of the United States would have dropped by 70 to 90%.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. No question about it. And I wanted to bring up, and I'm sure you personally are aware of this, in 1859,
yes,
there was a Harrington event, and I talk about this, I think I devote a whole chapter to
you
it.
You do, yes.
Civilization. In 1859, there was a very small, from an astrophysical, geophysical perspective, solar outburst, a couple of coronal mass ejections that hit Earth. And it didn't have a huge impact in 1859, but this is 1859. There wasn't a lot of electronics on the surface of the Earth.
But describe what did happen to the, like, to the telegraph.
Exactly. There were telegraph lines that were used by certain governments and by wealthy people and businesses. They went down. They were overloaded. Some of the telegraph stations burnt down, etc. But the average person, they saw all kinds of weird things in the sky. Some people thought the world was coming to an end. In fact, some people apparently end up in lunatic asylums, literally, because they got so upset about this. But it didn't have the ramifications it would have today, and it has been calculated that if we had simply a Carrington event, which was much smaller than the other events I was talking about over the last few thousand years that have now been discovered, even if we had only a Carrington event, it would be devastating to modern society. It would be devastating to the United States. We are, and I hate to draw analogies, but I will at the moment, if you'll allow me, COVID. We are in COVID right now. And we have learned, I think, some hard lessons from COVID, where we have become so, quote, efficient. And efficiency is maybe wonderful when everything's going smoothly, but when you have supply lines and manufacturing all localized in one place, and then something happens and that one supply line gets cut, this is another example, or that one manufacturing facility goes down, it's horrible.
Yeah,
it's horrible.
Absolutely.
We don't have redundancy that we had once. It's all this on demand. Oh, things will arrive on demand. Things aren't necessarily stockpiled. We aren't thinking about the future. Well, what if that factory goes down? What if that supply line we can't transport? If we have even a small solar event and knock out electrical grid systems, you're not going to be pumping gas. You're not going
no.
to
it would
have
be,
it. Most, I'm sorry, I just got to get this thought out.
Ahead,
most of our cars, what are our cars? We no longer have cars in the traditional way. We have computers on wheels that are hooked up to some kind of engine, be it gasoline or electric, with an electromagnetic pulse that would go with what's known as a proton event, a solar proton event. We would probably wipe out the electronics of virtually all modern vehicles. They wouldn't even start.
It's a terrifying prospect, and
it really is not all that far away.
Like right now, we're, I believe, if I'm not correct, in a period of a quiet sun. It's been quite quiet. The sun was quite quiet before the Carrington event.
That's right. That's right. People say to me, and I've had some people say to me who have looked into this a little bit, and I really don't want to sound the wrong way, but I'll say this. Sometimes when you have a little bit of knowledge, it's worse than just realizing you're ignorant about things. So sometimes people say, oh, we're going into a quiet sun. Everything's going to be fine. No, it's when you have a quiet sun, and this is the analogy I'll use. You have a quiet sun. The sun is building up energy inside. It seems quiet now. That's exactly when I expect it to really erupt.
Well, you know, when I wrote Solar Flares, I noted that most of the gigantic transformers in the United States are not properly shielded. They were shielding them in Europe, and some of them more have been shielded in this country. But we just saw in the catastrophe that befell Texas and much of the Old South what it means when we ignore these dangers. The danger of freezing was ignored, and the wind turbines that should have been winterized froze, but more importantly, the gas-fired power plants that should have been winterized and were mostly just open to the air. I mean, they weren't even in buildings, froze. Now, where are we with our electrical grid?
It's crazy. It's absolutely, to me, it's insane because you bring up, yes, Texas is a great example. What happened in Texas, from my perspective as a geologist, was so small in terms of what a natural event or natural catastrophe could be. And look at all the problems it caused.
Oh, God. I mean, I'm from Texas, and I have hundreds of friends and family there, so I'm well aware of those problems.
Yeah. And we weren't even prepared for what everyone expected. People might argue about solar flares and outbursts because we haven't seen anything since 1859, and, you know, it's much... You know,
but the longer we go, doesn't the danger rise?
Of course it does. Of course it does. It's inevitable. It's going to happen. And every day we're right on the edge. It could literally happen any time. But I wanted to get back to Texas. In Texas, they didn't prepare for things that they know are going to happen. I mean, who would not know that's going to happen? I mean, maybe there's some...
Well, it's true of the solar solar flares, too. It will happen.
Of course it will.
And we're not prepared. We're not preparing because people want to save money today. And the power companies in Texas are just like the ones in California. Penny wise and pound foolish. The California power companies are going to be spending billions and billions of dollars for years cleaning up the mess they allowed to happen, which they knew would happen. And the same is now true in Texas.
Yeah.
But if it's a big flare like the Carrington event, there ain't going to be anybody to clean up anything. We're going to be destroyed.
That's right. We're going to be destroyed. And not to reinforce it too much, but the Carrington event was fairly small compared to what we've known has happened in just a last few thousand years, much less what has happened on a cycle of, say, 11 to 13,000 years.
Now,
and we are coming to, and this is part of the point of forgotten civilization, this cycle of, let's say, around 11 to 12,000 years, we are back into that period of high activity. I am convinced. The major, major solar outburst that ended the last ice age was 9700 BCE, or 11,700 years ago. So I believe that the Carrington event in many ways is sort of the warning sign of the turbulence that the sun is going into, the disequilibrium, the agitation, however you want to express it, that the sun is going into it. And for us to ignore these warnings is, to me, preposterous. It's crazy.
Well, you know, at the end of the last ice age, a hell of a lot of solar energy reached the surface of the Earth, including heat. And, you know, if that happened now, with things already so warm, we're going to really be in a kind of final event, I would think.
Yeah, and we don't know exactly what the effects are going to be. This is something else that we have to be very cognizant of, because, for instance, as I reconstruct it now, and I talk about this in the especially the final chapter, which is a brand new chapter to the book Forgotten Civilization. I just, so people who have read it before should know, I put new material throughout the book.
Throughout the book, then, that's correct. And it's
then there's a new chapter, which I think may be the longest chapter in the book now. A brand new chapter putting together a lot of new information. And something I'm 100% convinced now is that it was a solar event that began the Younger Dryas. And so everyone knows what I'm talking about. At the end of the last ice age, there was a general warming trend until 10,900 BCE. And all of a sudden, we went into a cold snap. Some people have suggested that that cold snap was due to a comet. Having looked at the evidence very carefully, don't believe it was a comet. I believe it was a solar outburst. And what that solar outburst did at the time was it melted a number of glacial dams. It released huge amounts of pent-up glacial water that was in North America in particular. It dumped into the Atlantic it dumped into Atlantic, it changed ocean currents, and it caused a general cooling spell for 1,200 years, from about 10,900 BC to 9,700 BC, when we were hit by another major, major solar outburst, which then had the incredible warming effect planet-wide. So in both cases, it was a solar outburst, but given the condition of the planet at the two different times, 10,900 BC and 9,700 BC or BCE, you had different effects on the planet in terms of climate and earth changes, etc. So part of it is dependent on what the state of the system is when such an outburst hits. It's a little unpredictable what is going to happen when we get hit by the next major solar outburst. But what is very predictable, I think, is that it's going to be absolutely devastating for modern technological society and most of humanity, probably all of humanity, effectively. It's going to change things.
Well, yeah, that is the nature of our planet. It is very quiet and very reasonable for a lot of time, and then all of a sudden it turns into has a conniption fit. Our solar system,
exactly,
I mean.
Exactly.
Not just our planet.
I would say one thing. I'm a geologist, so I don't want to disagree with you, but I'm going to say, when you say a lot of time, I believe you're talking from a human perspective.
I am talking from a human perspective. No, from a geologic perspective, this place is in total chaos.
Yeah, exactly. From a geological perspective, I mean, 10,000-12,000 years is nothing. The Earth goes through these all the time from an Earth perspective. Let's think of the Earth as conscious, as we were talking about before. Oh, it goes through this all the time. Oh, it's just, hiccup.
Yeah, right.
The sun hiccups. Mm-hmm. But we really feel the ramifications as humans when that happens.
Well, one of the things I would like to talk about is exactly what happened to the mind of man, because your dating of the Sphinx is 10,000 BC, 10,000 years ago. Which is it?
No, about 10,000 BC.
So about the same time, essentially.
Yeah.
Now, the Sphinx is also identified with the lioness, I should say, right, with Leo, and a time of courage, which would have been essential to survival in those days.
I see where you're going, yeah.
Yeah, then you come next to Taurus, the strength, which is when civilizations were being rebuilt. Then comes Pisces. Then comes Aries. Then Pisces. And suddenly the little fish of mankind is swimming around in the waters of the earth, just getting everything he needs fed to him or her. Now we're at another change of the age, Aquarius. The water's being poured out, and we're being poured out with it, the little fish. Now, I see a consciousness behind all of that, because there is some kind of connection, in my mind at least, between those astrological ages and what is unfolding on the ground. Do you? Am I way off base or not?
I think it's very interesting that the astrological ages do seem to be something real. They represent something real. And if we want to call it this, or the collective mindset or consciousness on Earth, I wanted to make a point before I forget it, that when I've been talking about, okay, maybe a cycle on the order of 11 to 13,000 years for the sun, that is approximately half a precessional cycle. For those, I'm sure most of your viewers are familiar with the astrological ages and the precessional cycle, but a full cycle of the 12 ages is about 26,000 years. It actually varies over time. So it's interesting, and I found this correlation very, very interesting. I certainly didn't force it. I didn't expect it necessarily initially, but I also was not surprised by it, that it seems that our sun is on a half precessional cycle when it comes to the turbulence and agitation, etc. And when you start refining it more, there is some evidence that we have solar activity in periods of increased decreased solar activity that correlate to some extent with the precessional ages, even. That's still a little, you know, I'm looking into these types of things.
Right.
But I don't discount it at all. I do want to point out, too, with the Sphinx, and this is new since the first edition was published, we now know, based on hieroglyphic evidence and other evidence, that the Sphinx was, as I had postulated decades ago, was originally a lion. So I just want to make sure everyone's clear that the origins of the Sphinx, in my assessment, go back to before 9700 BCE, before the last ice age. So we can talk in general about maybe about 10,000 BC. So just as a round number. But it was not the Sphinx as we know it today. It was literally not a Sphinx. It was a lion, but we now know that on the ground, it was not a male lion, it was a lioness.
That's why I said lioness, yes.
Exactly.
I learned from
you
your book.
That, and I want to make sure everyone caught that,
right,
because it was a lioness, and we believe that it was Mehit, or Mehet, or Mehit. People, we don't really know how to pronounce the ancient Egyptian names.
No.
It was a lioness who was guarding a chamber, which Dr. Thomas DeBecky, the geophysicist, and I found back in the early 1990s seismically, and it was always somewhat of a mystery, although Edgar Cayce had predicted it, would be found there underneath the paws, underneath the left paw specifically. And we now have, among the earliest hieroglyphic evidence going back over 5,000 years, so the earliest hieroglyphs, that yes, in fact, those Egyptians 5,000 years ago during dynastic times recognized that the original Sphinx was a lioness. They considered this to be a very ancient structure, a very ancient statue carved out of the bedrock that was guarding a chamber underneath. So the dynastic head, the current modern, when I say modern, I'm a geologist. It's over 4,000 years old. But the early, the dynastic head that we now see on the Sphinx, the human head, is a recarving. That was recarved from the head of the lioness, which I believe, I'm convinced, had become very eroded, very weathered.
It's so old.
Over thousands of years. So they recarved it in dynastic times. 4,600, 700, 800 years ago, I think it was early dynastic times, for whatever reason, they carved it as a human head
right.
rather than another lioness.
Well, they were probably forgetting a lot of their, of the...
Exactly.
And this gets me to two things. The first is, free Dreamlanders, it's time to say goodbye. And I'm sorry about that, but... Subscribers, we're going to keep on for another half hour. And during that time, we're going to talk about what was lost in the past. We made brief references to Gunung Padang and Nan Madol. We haven't yet talked about Göbekli Tepe. We have not talked about what was lost in terms of our engineering, and also an incredible appendix in this book. It was just full of incredible stuff. An appendix about Easter Island, Rapa Nui, and psychokinesis. It's going to really blow your mind. Free Dreamlanders, thank you so much for being with us on Dreamland. And as always, I urge you to subscribe. We're talking to Robert Schoch. His book, Forgotten Civilizations, the revised version, full of fabulous new material. Don't miss it.